there's no clouds in the sky, and the sparrow can't fly, if that isn't love, then heaven's a myth. There's no feeling like this. If that isn't love.
Revelation chapter 3. We're going to pick it up in verse, down at verse 14. Revelation chapter 3, verse 14. It says, and unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write these things, saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither hot nor cold. I would thou wert cold or hot. You know something about liquids in this respect. If you drink a liquid that's supposed to be hot and it's cold, it's like... And if you drink a liquid that's supposed to be hot and it's cold, then it's like... It just don't taste good. And he says right here, I know that he says that I would that thou were cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich. And white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. And anoint thine eyes with eye salve. Excuse me. And anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Now, Father, I do thank you, Lord, for tonight. I thank you for the music. I thank you, Lord, for your word. And I just ask you, Father in heaven, that you would bless the preaching. I thank you for those that are here tonight. Now, Father, I pray that you would enter in amongst us, Lord, and that you would minister to each person in this room. Father, let not a single soul from Josiah right on up through to Brother Walt not have you meet with them and speak to them. Lord, help them to hear and to understand. And Father, we just ask that you would bless the preaching of your word. I thank you for it, Father, and I pray that it would accomplish the thing you desired it to do. And I thank you for the desire that you have for us, Lord, and the desire of the work that you're trying to do in us. And thank you for being so patient with us, Father. And thank you for caring enough to try and to do these things. And Father, we just ask that you would please accomplish a work in our hearts and in our minds. Father, help us not to be an obstinate, hard-hearted people. Lord, help us to be willing to hear you, to listen to you, and obey you. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Now, right here in Revelation chapter 3, he's dealing with the church of the Laodiceans, and there's a condition that coincides with the Laodicean church and that of the Pharisees of Jesus' day. If you would, look down in verse 17. Verse 17, he says, because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not. You know, the Lord looks at things so differently than the way man looks at it. Man looks at his physical condition and thinks, well, if I got food and I got a little extra money set aside, I don't need anything. And the Lord says, you don't even know that thou art wretched and miserable and poor. But then he says, and blind. And look in verse 18. He says, I counsel thee to buy of me gold, try it in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. A condition that is prevalent that God shows us here in the Laodicean church is they don't have eyes to see. They're blind. It's a condition that the Pharisees had when he showed up on this earth. It's a condition, though, I believe that the Lord have us to see, that when he's given us this in the Laodicean church, he's not talking about physical blindness. He is talking about spiritual blindness, and it is a prevailing condition that he lists with the Laodicean church, a condition of spiritually blind people. They're born again. They're part of the church, but they are spiritually blind. Take your Bible for a minute and go to Luke chapter 4, verse 18. When Jesus Christ first shows up and he starts preaching, he goes to different places, and then he comes to his hometown of Nazareth in verse 16. He comes into the synagogue, and he stands up to read, and the priest gives him the book of Isaiah, and he starts to read, and he gives us verse 18. It says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight. Notice the word that God gives us there, recovering. Recovering of sight to the blind. To recover something, it means to regain. It means to regain. To regain. To get or obtain that which was lost. To get or obtain that which was lost. You know, when God created you and You came out of your mother's womb and you were just a little thing and you were crying and naked as a jaybird. You could have cared less. You hadn't sinned yet. And believe it or not, you had more spiritual understanding as a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5-year-old kid than most adults have in the Laodicean church age. I hate to say that, but it's the living truth. The reality is there was one day when you were as sinless gets. You were just in an able body that could sin. And then one day you decided that, hey, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to do what I want to do, and I don't care what mom says or dad says. And you chose to sin for the very first time. And then you became blind because of sin. And that condition prevails over mankind. Mankind cannot see Jesus Christ. Now, how can you not see him who fills heaven and earth? How can you not see something that fills heaven and earth unless you're just plain blind? Amen. And here the condition is, Jesus Christ has shown us that God has sent him to recover sight. Now, Jesus Christ, and many times in the New Testament, he shows us his ability to recover sight from the physically blind. But this condition that he's dealing with and I'm dealing with tonight is not physically blind. It is spiritually blind. And if you talk to people today about the Word of God, it doesn't take you long to find out who has no eyes to see. You can talk to folks and you ask them about the Word of God, they have no idea what it means to be born again and have eternal life. There's a lot of there's a lot of churches that if you were to ask them, and they say that they're born again, they say they're saved, they claim that they've been saved, but if you ask them doctrines of the book, they look at you like a deer in the headlights. What does that mean? What does it mean to be predestined before the foundation of the world? What does it mean to have Jesus Christ as my propitiation? What does it mean to have, what are the doctors? You start talking doctrine to a lot of people who claim to be Christian, and they look at you like, they ain't ever heard that stuff. You know, the condition of the church, I want to say this about the Laodicean church, it's not a very popular church in the Bible, amen? All right, I got one amen. I got a long way to go tonight, I can see. Is there something wrong with the preaching, or is there something wrong with the spirit in the church tonight? The fact of the matter is, the Laodicean church is what I'm dealing with tonight. And I got a bunch of Laodicean, no. The reality being is, God knows the condition of the Laodicean church. He put it out there way back for the Apostle John to write it out, so when that time came to you and I, we could see something, we could address something, and we wouldn't partake of it. I don't know about you, I do not want to live a Laodicean lifestyle. I don't see anything impressive about it. I don't see anything that draws me to think, oh, I want to be in that church, but I'm here. I live in the Laodicean church age. I live with Laodicean Christians. I don't want to be one of them. And if you want to be one of them, put your fingers in your ears, cover your eyes, and just sit back, relax, and pretend like God has nothing to tell you tonight, amen. God has something to tell you tonight about the Laodicean church. And it's a church that he has got the ability to remedy their situation. He tells them how to do it and how to handle it. And he says that in Luke chapter 4, he says that God sent him to recover the sight of the blind. The condition of the Laodicean church is the same as that of the Pharisees. The blind guides, he called them. Blind guides. You know, we got a bunch of blind guides leading the body of Christ today. They can't tell the difference between a King James, New King James, an ASV, an RV, TEV. They can't tell the difference between the New World Translation of the Holy Scriptures, which ain't holy at all. New World puke is all that stuff is. They can't tell the difference between that stuff. And a lot of God's children who are saved, going to heaven, can't tell that they're being led by a blind man. The blind is leading the blind in the body of Christ. And it ought not to be that way. You know why? I'm going to say something to you tonight, and I don't want to offend you, but if it offends you, if the shoe fits, wear it. You should not be deceived. If you are deceived, it's your own fault. You were told by God to study to show thyself approved and not blame it all on the pastor. Well, the pastor taught me that. God's going to ask you, what did you do with my book? And I'm going to encourage you tonight to don't be like these blind guides. Jesus Christ looked at him and said, ye fools and blind. That's his heart attitude toward those Pharisees. Ye fools and blind. You know what he called us, the Laodicean church? Blind. Just like that Pharisee, just as blind as a bat. And he says, I got a cure. He looks at those blind Pharisees. He says, the blind lead the blind. What happens when the blind lead the blind? They both fall in the ditch. You know what the Laodicean church is doing? Heading for the ditch. You know why the Laodicean church isn't doing much in the world? Half of them are in the ditch. I say 3/4 of them are in the ditch. They don't do much when they're in a ditch. Amen. You know what they're doing? They're just blindly following, blindly following, blindly following. I want to bring a message tonight on how not to be that Laodicean, be a Laodicean church. The Lord has the answers for that. Now take your Bible for a minute. I want to show you what happens to a blind man in John chapter 9. John chapter 9. John chapter 9, look down at verse 30. Now, this is the blind man who was born blind. His parents are going to be brought in, and the Pharisees are going to try to get them to say things. He doesn't want to say anything. They don't want to say anything because they're afraid they're going to get thrown out of the synagogue. So he's talking to them, and he's telling them what Jesus Christ did. And I don't know about you, but sometimes you talk to born-again Christians in the body of Christ today, and you tell them how great Jesus is and how good Jesus has been to you, and they look at you just like these people here and think, what do you mean Jesus can do that? What do you mean? It's an amazing thing. John chapter 9, look down at verse 30. Pharisees have told him in verse 9, he says, we know God spake unto Moses. As for this fellow, this fellow, my friend, just happens to be God incarnate. Well, as for this fellow, you know, the one that created the world, this planet, the stars, and gives us breath and strength and everything, we don't even know him. That's a lot like the Laodicean church age today. Amen, amen. I don't hate to say it. I'm glad to say it, just to reveal it out to you. The Laodicean church is a pathetic church. Jesus Christ is so fed up with that church, he says, I would like to spew you right out of my mouth. That's not a church I want to be like. That's not a man I want to be like. I don't want to make my Savior sick. When he tastes me, I want him to taste heat. I don't want to be cold. I don't want to be one of those Laodicean Christians that says, well, then I'll just be cold. He'll love me because I'm cold. No, be hot for him. Be hot. You know why he says, I'd rather you were cold? Because when you're cold, you shut your mouth and you're not in the way. That's the only blessing you are when you're cold for God. You just shut your mouth completely and you're not in the way anymore. God don't want that either, but he'd rather you were that than some lukewarm, half-nut Christian walking around with their head in the sky thinking that everything's all right, peachy clean, and we're going to live forever. Just trust God. And that fellow looks at those Pharisees, and verse 30 says, the man answered and said unto them, why herein is a marvelous thing, that ye know not from whence he is, and yet he hath opened mine eyes. Now we know that God here, now he's going to go into teacher mode here. He's going to go into preacher mode. And he's going to say something. He says, now we know that God heareth not sinners, but if any man be a worshiper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth. Since the world began, was it not heard that any man opened the eyes of one that was born blind? If this man, now I'm going to tell you something right about there. That Pharisees, those Pharisees are just sweating. They're hearing a profession from a man who was born blind, and he's just letting them know exactly how it happened, what took place. And I want you to know something. He's looking right at those bunch of Pharisees that are supposed to be leading everybody with their great intellect and their great understanding, and he's telling them, well, this is a marvelous thing. You don't even know who he is. He opened my eyes, and you have no idea who he is. This is a marvelous thing. He says, oh, by the way, did you ever know that since the world began, nobody ever did that? You know what that man's got? He's got sight. He can see something that those Pharisees cannot see. They are blind as a bat. So he's trying to help them. He's trying to help them see something. If this man were not a God, he could do nothing. They answered and said unto him, thou wast altogether born in sins. What an answer from the blind. This is the Laodicean warning that God shows you to the blind. Thou wast altogether born in sins, and dost thou teach us? And dost thou teach us? You know what one of the earmarks of the Pharisee is? You can't teach them nothing. You can't teach them nothing. They're too smart. They know everything. They have problems in their life they don't know how to fix, but they're all right. They can handle everything. They never go to God because they don't see God as that they need God. They just God's convenient to have around. You know, the problem with the Laodicean church is they can't be taught. They can't be instructed. You tell a Laodicean church to do something, and 9 times out of 10, they'll get mad at you and just look at you with the attitude of, who are you to tell me to do anything? That's a Laodicean heartbeat. They're just blind. And thou wast altogether born in sins, and dost thou teach us? Notice in Revelation chapter 3, now, what I'm preaching tonight I'm not saying this is you particular, but if it's you and the Lord's going to speak to you, and I hope the Lord speaks to each one of us tonight. In Revelation chapter 3, verse 14, he says, and unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans, right? This is the general condition of that church. When God looks down upon that church of the Laodiceans, this is the condition he sees it in. He sees them like this right here, blind. But you notice about something that he says in that church, to that church? He says to that church the remedy. He gives that church the remedy. He says in verse 18, anoint thine eyes. Anoint thine eyes with eye salve that thou mayest see. Anoint thine eyes with eye salve that thou mayest see. You know, when the Lord looks down upon that church, Jesus sees their eyes as number one. You know what he sees? He sees their eyes as neglected. He sees a church that's neglecting their eyes. Their eyes are in need of something, and they're not getting it. Their eyes are being abused on a daily basis, and they're not addressing it. You know what the Bible says? He says right here in Psalms 101 verse 3. Take your Bible and go there. Psalm 101 verse 3. You want to know what's happening to the Laodicean church age? You want to know why the Laodicean church age is so dead and has no strength with God? Because they're as unholy, they're probably the most unholy church of all seven of them. They are contaminated with something. They are contaminated. They're blind. They cannot see. They think they've got everything. They think they're okay. What do you do with a person who thinks he's okay, and yet God's trying to get it through the thick head? You're poor, miserable, wretched, and blind. That's what God has to deal with when he's dealing with you tonight. You're poor, miserable, wretched, and blind, but you think you're okay. How does God get through to a man like that? How does God get through to a woman that is poor, miserable, wretched, and blind, naked, but you think you're rich and increased with good and have need of nothing? How is he ever going to help them? Well, anoint thine eyes, he says. He has the remedy. He has the remedy. In Psalms 101, verse 3, it says this right here. I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. I will set. You know what you've done with your eyes? You've neglected to obey Psalm 101, verse 3. You have so much filth that you've taken in through those eyes that God, amen. You know why God doesn't want to touch you? Don't get mad at me. I ain't the one who plopped your eyeballs in front of that television set and let you watch what you watch. I'm not the one who says go turn the TV on and go turn. Don't worry, just because I'm using TV, you can turn on, you can find pornography on the internet just as quick as you can find it in the Playboy magazine. The problem with the Laodicean church is they're filthy dirty with their eyes. They will not respect the fact that your eyes are the window to that soul. And that soul, my friend, is what God redeemed. And that vessel that you are in is God's vessel. It's to the church. This ain't to some lost heathen man who has nothing to do with God. He's addressing his own children, and he's saying, you've set such wicked stuff before your eyes, you've neglected to keep your eyes pure. And he sees your eyes as completely neglected. You know what you do if you neglect your eyes? If Sister Jade didn't put corrective glasses on, and if Mrs. Phelps didn't have corrective glasses on, and Brother Mike didn't have corrective glasses on, eventually, you know what happened to them? They couldn't see nothing. You neglect your eyes, and I'm going to tell you something. You're going to be just like the Pharisee. You're going to fit the shoes that this Laodicean church age fit. You have neglected your eyes, and Christ is trying to tell you, stop looking at that stuff. Why are you looking at filth and trash? Why would a preacher have to preach to you in the Laodicean age that don't look at a pornographic picture? To me, it's the most absurd thing that I would have to preach a message not to look at pornography to a bunch of Bible-believing Christians. But that's what God has laid upon my heart. Don't be looking at it. Why in the world would I, as a preacher, have to stand up here and look at you, my Christian brothers, and say, get your eyes off that filth? You've neglected them, and it's taken its toll. And bless God, if you think that your eyes can take in that kind of filth and not have a consequence brought upon you, you are blind, amen. God told you to take care. Set no wicked thing before thine eyes. I will set no wicked thing. That's what King David said. I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. Jesus Christ looks down, and he don't see a heart that wants him. He sees a heart that goes after adultery. Having eyes, says in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 14, the thing you want right now, young man, some of you old men, the thing you want right now is you want to see another naked lady, amen. And you don't want to hear from God tonight. You just want to get it over with and get out and go do what you want to do and spend your Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday doing what you want to do and not what God wants you to do. And then you're going to beg God for his blessings and ask him, why won't you help me? Where are you, God? Why won't you give me grace? Why won't you give me patience? Why won't you help me out? Bless God, clean up your life, amen. Get it out of your life. Why would a pastor have to preach to a Bible-believing church to get rid of pornography? To me, it is the most repulsive, repugnant, stupid thing a man would have to do. But I have to. Why? Because the Laodicean church has eyes full of adultery. You can't wait to see what the next one looks like. You know, women all look the same, brother. A holy father sending a blessed son to get a wretch like you out of hell so he can stand in heaven and watch you play around with filth. And you think God's okay with it. You do greatly err not knowing the Savior I know. You blind, boy. You blind. Having eyes full of adultery. Take your Bible, go to Isaiah chapter 59. My wife wants to get the internet at my house. And this ain't against my wife. It's just the way I am. Isaiah chapter 59. You know why I don't want the internet at my house? Too much filth on that thing. Too much potential for filth in that thing. I don't need the internet. I'm happy without it. I don't need pornography. I'm happy without it. I don't want that. Isaiah chapter 59. Isaiah chapter 59. It says in Isaiah 59 verse 10, it says, we grope for the wall like blind men. And we grope as if we had no eyes. You know what grope means? Grope is what a blind man, a real physical blind man does. He goes like this. If he's going to walk, he's going to go like this right here. This is groping. You know what the Laodicean church is doing? They're groping. They're walking by feeling. If it feels okay, go there. You know what feels good to have sex? Oh, why don't we go there? You know what feels good to fornicate? Well, why don't we go there? You know what feels good to drink? Well, why don't we go there? It feels good anyway, don't it? Amen? What, no amens? Yeah, it does. Just because it feels good doesn't mean you should be doing it. You grope. You groping. The Bible says we grope, they grope. They grope for the wall like blind men. It means to search by feeling in the dark. The Laodicean church, they're trying to find God. They're groping around. They ain't even trying to find God. They're trying to find their next way to sin. Blind men. Blind women. Groping in the dark, living their Christian life by feeling. I like what Pastor said. He gets so sick of Christians that this, well, I don't feel that way. You live your entire life by your feelings. You are blind. You are supposed to live by character and by the word of the Lord. I don't have to grope at what the Bible says. The Bible says, look not thou, and I'll get to that in a minute. The Bible says, don't do. I don't have to read. I don't have to wonder what it means. Just don't do it. The Bible says, flee youthful lust. I know exactly what that means. It means beat feed it out of there, boy. That's what it means. Don't sit there and try to figure out, well, what does it mean? Man, it means run when you're being tempted. Don't stand there and think you're going to outdo it and last it and you're big enough to handle this. No, you're not big enough to handle sin. Sin's handling you. And the Lord looking down upon his church, he's saying, you've neglected your eyes. You need to anoint them. You need to put something on them, poor things, because they've been neglected. You know what he sees when he sees your eyes? He doesn't see those beautiful pearly blues and greens. He sees the church of Laodicea that they have neglected their eyes. They've seen things they ought not to see. You know, because of television, how many of you have seen things you ought not to see? I'm telling you, it's not right for a man to look at another woman's body. It ain't right. And for you to watch a television show where it accentuates a woman's body and it gets you all hot and bothered, that ain't right. And for you to sit there and watch the television set, it ain't right. Put the stupid thing off. Don't sit there and wait for mom and dad to take it and shut it off. Shut it off for mom and dad. If they ain't got the common sense to get the filth out, then stand up and say, Mom, why are you watching that? Stand and look at dad and say, Dad, what's the matter with you? Why are you looking at that? Dad, shut that thing off. My God, you know what that does to young boys? You know what that does to young boys? I'll tell you what it does to young boys. It makes them think things they ought not to think, and they can't get it out of their head. But you're so stupid. You're so blind. You sit right there and watch it with your 14-year-old daughter, and you think it has no consequence. You're blind. You can't separate the holy from the profane. Blind. You know what God says? You need something. You need something. You know why you're going after pornography and filth and trash and booze? You know why you're going after that? Because you need something that you ain't getting. It's a terrible thing when a man or a woman goes after that filth when they have a man or a woman to live with. That Bible tells you in Proverbs, be thou ravished always with her love. Let her breast satisfy thee at all times, and be thou ravished always with her love. Now, I'm going to tell you something, young man. You got a wife, that's all you need. I'm going to tell you, that's all you need. God knows your manhood. God knows what's in you. God knows what you're made of. And all you need is your wife. You don't need to look at another one. I'm going to tell you what happens to poor women, that their husbands look at other women. And I'm talking pornographic looking at other women. They start turning their poor woman, who's supposed to be a godly woman, into a whore or a prostitute that he can burn his sexual lust upon. I got one amen. That woman wasn't made for that. Groping. Blind. Blind. Setting things before their eyes that they ought not to set. Having eyes, the Bible says, full of adultery. You just can't wait to think another dirty thought about some other woman. And you wonder why you come to church and you can't find God and you can't go, praise God. You wonder why there's no praise God, hallelujah, thank God. You wonder why you don't smile like Sister Eileen. You wonder why you don't have a smile upon your face. How could you have a smile? You ought to be filthy, dirty, and guilty as hell, amen. I don't feel sorry for you. I don't think you ought to be shooting and hollering and dancing around the church. You ought to be begging God to forgive you. But no, you think you deserve the right because you're old enough for what? You know what God says? Your eyes need something. Your eyes need something. What do they need, Father? They need ointment. They need something. They need ointment. Anoint thine eyes with eye salve. Now you want to talk about a verse. How many of you ever had salve on your finger? How many of you going to put that in your eye? You ain't going to see me do it. It irritate the fire out of you. But God says, no, your eyes need something. They need salve. You know what salve also means? Salve is a confection, it says. Salve is this right here, a glutinous composition applied to wounds or sores. But you know salve has another meaning? It means help. Just simply means help. Anoint thine eyes with eye help. Eye salve. Something that's healthy for your eyes. And no, I'm not talking carrots. Anoint thine eyes with eye salve. Your eyes need something. They don't need what they're seeing. It needs something else. Anoint thine eyes with eye salve. It means help. Take your Bible, go to Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. It says, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of the water by the word. Washing of the water by the word. You know what? Your eyes need help. You know when you got dirty things in your eyes, you have to wash them out, amen? You know when your truck gets dirty, you know what you'll do? You'll put a couple dollars in some place, and you'll take care of your truck. You'll go down there, you'll buy, get whatever it takes. You need to polish it, wax it, shine it. You'll take the money out, and you'll take care of your truck. You'll take care of your car. Make sure it shines. Make sure it looks pretty. Make sure it looks like it's a new one if it's a new one. And yet you'll neglect your eyes, and they need help. They need help. They need to be washed. They've been seeing too much filth. You need to wash them. You need to wash the dirt out of them. You know what's happened to you? You've built an addiction. My wife and I, years ago, she asked me if I'd go to the Hong Kong, and I said, I don't want to go there. We started going to the Hong Kong. She started eating these little things called crab rangoon. And I said, I don't like them things. I hate them things. She said, well, try them again. And I tried it again. And she said, try it again. So I tried it again. You know, after a while, I built up a liking to them. It's my wife's fault that I go to the Hong Kong. I didn't want to go. I really didn't. But you know what? Over the years, I started getting to the point where, you know, I look forward to eating them again next Sunday. I've built up a desire for them. You know what you've done? You've built up a desire within you that should not be in there. And now you have to take some steps and wash it out. Anoint thine eyes with eye salve. Wash that brain of yours with the water of the word. Get the filth out. And I'll tell you what, it wouldn't hurt you a bit to go to heaven, your heavenly Father, and confess what you're doing. And tell him, Lord, I have a problem with this. It's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord. I'm blind. I'm foolish. I'm being stupid. And I'm addicted. I'm addicted. You put that filth in your eyes, young man. And all the devil's got to do. You do it willingly. You sit there and open up them filthy magazines. Or you watch that television set. Or you put on that internet. And you let that stuff come into your eyeballs willingly. God will let the devil bring that back to you whenever that devil wants to and flash that filth right in front of your brain. And I'll tell you what, he can torture you with that garbage, especially when you desire, in the future, you may desire to want to be holy and clean. And the devil says, yeah, right, fat chance. But I want to be clean, fat chance. I want to be clean, fat chance. I don't want to look at that no more. Too bad. Don't that Bible say you reap what you sow? You better start sowing some righteousness, buddy, and you better start putting that TV off or putting the magazines away. God forbid you got Playboy and Penthouse, whatever name else they got out there now. And you think it ain't hurting you. You're blind. You're blind to holiness. It affects you. It affects your family. It affects your wife. It affects your husband. And it affects your children. But you got an appetite for it, Brother Richards. I gotta. No, you don't. But you're addicted. And you know what the sad thing is? You'll sit right there and deny it. And the Bible goes on to tell you about the Laodicean church. You're miserable. And wretched. Those are adjectives of our Laodicean church. Aren't they great? Ain't they something to live up to? You know, your son or daughter is going to live up to you. Wretched. Poor. Blind. Blind. You know something else about this text? Number one, he says, they're neglected eyes. That's what he sees. He sees eyes that are in need. They got so much dirty filth in them that he wants you to wash them out, get them cleaned out. Clean them. Clean them eyes. Notice what he says, though, in Revelation chapter 3. Watch what he does. And I think it's right. I know it's right. It's in the Word of God, but I still think it's right. Revelation chapter 3. Watch what he says. He says to the blind that cannot see what they're doing. They can't see a thing about what they're doing to their kids and family. He says, anoint thine eyes with eye salve that thou mayest see. But he told you to do it. You know what that is? That's God saying to you, you allowed it. You allowed this. Now, if you want my help, I'm sure God will help you out. But he says, I'm not helping you till you start helping yourself. And buddy, I'll tell you what, to me, that is holy. That is just. If you think he's going to try to help you out while you refuse to shut off that filthy garbage, you are blind as a bat, buddy. God says, no, you anoint your eyes. I'll do the healing. But you put the anointment on. Why? They're thine eyes. I don't have to look at what you looked at. I don't have to live with what you looked at. I have to live with what I've looked at. So he tells that Laodicean church, anoint thine eyes. You do it. You take care of those eyes. That Bible says in Proverbs chapter 23, verse 31, it says, look not thou upon the wine when it is red, when it moveth itself aright. God didn't say don't drink it. He told you don't even look at it. Why are you looking? Well, I didn't know that verse was in there, Brother Richards. Well, it's a good thing you're here tonight then, isn't it? It's a good thing you came in. Look not thou upon the wine when it is red. You know what the sad thing is about young folks who haven't tasted alcohol? You don't know how blessed you are. And the devil's trying to tell you, take a drink. Take a drink. You'll be glad you did. No, you won't. No, you won't. You got to go look at some professional drinkers. You never see the professionals on television. All you see is the beauties that haven't gotten down the road very far. Because once they get down the road, they change the channel and put another pretty woman out there. They get another bimbo or bozo that's going to go out there and drink and look cool with a Coors in his hand. Well, why don't you go show him a 70-year-old man who's lost his wife and 8 kids to booze and alcohol? Why don't you put that on television? You say, that don't happen. My Uncle Clinton, don't tell me it don't happen, lost his entire family to that filth. Lived to be about 85 years old, died, nobody went to his funeral. You know what he said to everybody in the family? He said, please don't come to my funeral. I tried to talk to that man 5 times, 4 or 5 times, I don't even know how many times, 2 or 3 times anyways, right in his house about the Lord. I don't want to know that. Don't tell me about that. You know what God says? God says, you're a mess. Mr. Laodicean. Mrs. Laodicean, you're a wreck. You're miserable, wretched, poor, blind, and you don't even know it. You think everything's going to be fine, and it's not. You're poor, wretched, blind. So, anoint thine eyes. Take the time to do the corrective measures that you need to do for your eyes. That means you have to shut the television off. That means you have to change the internet. And if you have to throw the stupid thing out the door. I'm not just saying words, buddy. That stuff's addictive. And if you've got dirty magazines, good night, man. What do you think I'm going to tell you to do? Put it under your pillow. Burn it, amen! Get rid of it. Play around with that filth. You play around with it long enough, it'll play with you. And it'll own you. You know what David said? I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. You said, Brother Richards, you already gave us that one. Yeah, but you're Laodicean, amen. We're Laodicean, amen. I thought it'd be good to give it to you again. Why? Because we have what's called a television set. And that has been a great tool for the enemy of your Savior that he has used to propagate to you it's okay. He has desensitized you to everything that's morally good. And he did it by your lusts through that television set. The devil ain't stupid. You are. I'm big enough. I'm old enough. I'm man enough. The devil said, oh, yes, you are. Oh, you are. You're a tough one. You got it. That's how you go fishing. You put the bait out there that they want. And then you just set the hook. And when that fish tries to run, you say, ain't it fun being where the devil wants you? Ain't it fun? You know, every time you try to make progress or every time you want to do something, the devil just says, Mr. Laodicea? I wonder if you realize maybe you need some help. Psalmist told you not to set anything wicked before your eyes. But you didn't need God's help. After all, he's only God. What would he know? You got Laodiceans. That's what the problem is. Blind. I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. Take your Bible and go to Song of Solomon. You know what I think? I think God is very good to you and I. And I think he loves us very much. I think he knows the dangers of sin. And he knows the cure. Song of Solomon, chapter 5. They're your eyes. Song of Solomon, chapter 5. Look down at verse 10. My beloved is white and ruddy. Ruddy. The chiefest among 10,000s. His head is as the most fine gold. Remember he said, buy me gold, try it in the fire? His locks are bushy and black as a raven. His eyes are as the eyes of doves by the rivers of waters, washed with milk. You know why you look at what you look at? Do you know why you look at what you look at? Because you ain't looking at this. And your eyes aren't washed. You know, I don't blame you for not wanting to come to church. Who would want to come around this place? That man in the back preaches righteousness to you every time he gets in the pulpit. This man preaches righteousness to you every time he steps in that pulpit. I don't blame you for not wanting to come. But I'll tell you two things I know for a fact. That man in the back ain't changing. And neither is this one. And if you want to walk out of here with your pornography, adios amigos. I'm giving you the cure to help you out. Pornography is a dangerous, deadly thing. And it kills the soul inside. Whoso committeth adultery with a woman, whoso looketh upon a woman and lusteth after her with his eyes, hath committed. Whosoever committeth adultery with a woman destroyeth his own soul. I'm preaching to help you out. And you know what you're doing? You're standing there and you're obstinate saying, it ain't me, it ain't me. It's you, amen. Why don't you admit it and let God help you out? God forbid, man, let me out of here. Get me out of here. Where are you going to run to? That's where you're running to. Oh, don't you worry. He's got another pretty one just waiting for you. And she is a knockout. And she is hot. You know what Christ's eyes were? Washed with milk. You know what you might want to find yourself doing? Washing your eyes with milk. As a newborn babe, desire the sincere milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. You know what your eyes need? They need the Bible. And I'm not talking the NIV. Can't help you. I'm not talking the New World Translation of their own holy scriptures and imaginations. That can't help you. The Word of God, however, is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit of the joints and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Don't tell me you can't understand why I don't read my Bible. I know why you don't read your Bible. Every time you read your Bible, those filthy eyes are getting washed by the milk of the Word of God. Washed with milk and fitly set. You know, one day, hallelujah, you know, one day, each and every one, you saved in here tonight? You know, one day your eyeballs are going to meet His eyeballs. The Bible says one day we're going to see Him face to face. We sing a song. Face to face with Christ my Savior. Face to face, what will it be? My God, what will it be? When He looks into those two eyes of yours and He sees what you've been seeing, will it be a blissful moment? Or will He have to turn away from looking at what you've been looking at? You know, there's a price to be a Christian. It's worth paying. It's worth paying. Yeah. And you couch potato slush bag, it's worth paying. You ought to be giving Him more than what you're giving Him. Don't call me a slush bag couch potato. Scumbag scuffed potato. Brethren, I'm not being hard. I am just telling you, how can a preacher stand up here and preach against pornography so late in the church age that we are living in and actually knowing that somebody must be having trouble with it? Now, I'm not picking on you, but I am not going to be, by God's grace, I'm not going to placate it. I'm not going to mamby-pamby it for you. I'm not going to soften the blow for you. That is lack of character, filthiness of the filthiest. And don't tell me you can't get over it. I got over it. How? Crying out to God. Asking Him. Repenting over what I had looked at willfully. Begging Him to take those pictures out of my mind. Telling Him, Lord, I did it in ignorance. Didn't understand. Tortured and tormented by pictures I never want to see again. God's been good to this boy. Don't tell me God can't help you. But I'm going to tell you something. I've read this book over 20 times. I study this book every week to feed people. I'm not saying these for braggadocious things. I'm saying I needed help, boy. I needed help. And there's a lot of milk went through these eyeballs. And it's worked. It's working. Hallelujah, it's working. And I'll close with this right here. Jesus Christ said in Revelation chapter 3, verse 14, verse 18. And if you want to stand there or sit there, and just tell yourself that it's just Brother Richards, then you knock yourself out. I pray that God would sit and talk with each one of you in His own way tonight. And the Lord, I believe, would have you to read to yourself the first three words of Revelation chapter 3, verse 18. You read it. Now it's between you and Him. If you think that what I said wasn't the truth, that's between you and Him. But if you think you're going to get away with it, you're going to stay blind, miserable, poor, naked. Now we're going to have an invitation. You know, I just...
Even in death, He remembered the the sparrow can't fly. There's no fear.